This is the day the Lord has made. Rejoice, be glad in it. And good morning to all of you who have joined our video worship service again this Sunday, May the 24th. Welcome. And to all those of you who are new this morning, we're glad to have you. Fred Beck, my colleague on the right here, and myself, Kit Schooley, along with the rest of the staff of the Guilford Park congregation, want to say thank you to you, a job well done. You've been consistent in your presence at the various activities that the church has sustained during this period. You've been continuing the work and support of others in the congregation. Each week, one of the staff members hears a story of something that one of you has done for another brother or sister in Christ of this congregation, and we applaud you for that. Next Sunday, May 31st, is Pentecost, and it's a long tradition for us in this congregation to wear red at worship on Pentecost Sunday. And so next Sunday, as you draw up to your computer or your television or however you join this worship, I encourage you to wear red. You'll be able to see it, and you'll feel like you are part of the larger Guilford Park worshiping community. And now, let us worship God.
Thank you. For God so loved the world.
The sparrow, the red fox, the fish, and the people.
For God so loved the world.
In success and failure, in pandemic and seclusion, in fear and courage.
For God so loved the world.
Enough to become one of us, enough to suffer along with us, enough to offer new life for us.
For God so loved the world, we worship him in love.
Let us worship God.
The scripture this morning comes from a portion of the Gospel of John, from the 15th chapter, 5 verses, the 12th to the 17th. So we all listen now for the word of God. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do as I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello, all my young friends. Peace be with you and also with you. I brought something with me today. You may recognize it. It sits in my office, and inside this box are lots and lots and lots of lollipops. And I love sharing with my young friends and my older friends too. It is fun to watch when those youngsters, when all you guys, you students, come to find a sucker. You come and you look and you dig down deep because you have a favorite one and you must have that favorite one. And you search and you search, and sometimes you take a very long time before you find your favorite. Now, sometimes two of you want the same one and there's only one in there and you fight. Oh, you fight for it. Like it, everything that you have rests on whether you get this favorite lollipop. Sometimes you even cry. You are so sad when you do not get the favorite that you want. In our scripture today, we heard, "Love one another as I have loved you." We talk a lot about loving one another, about how we can show that love, but what does that mean, as I have loved you? Well, that means we are to love everyone, our old friends, our new friends, our families, our school friends, even the friends we haven't met yet, as if they were our favorite. We love them like they were our favorite. We search and search to make sure that people we know have a voice and know that we love them and that they are seen. We fight and we fight for people who don't have enough so that they will have what they need. And sometimes we cry with each other when they are sad. We want to love each other like everyone is our favorite, because that's what Jesus taught us, and that's what God taught us, is to love everyone that, like they were our favorite. God loved us first. That's how we know how to love. And God loves us like we are his favorite, because you are God's favorite. We are all God's favorite. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you because you first loved us. Thank you for teaching us to love. Help us to show love to everyone, to one another, like they are all our favorite. Amen.
Pray with me. Lord, we are all in different boats, but we've made it this far. We give thanks for the life you give, the word you offer, and this chance to hear your word made into other words to enliven your word. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. The gospel writer's pretty clear. You did not choose me. I chose you. But what's the difference? We chose God. God chose us. In the end, we're chosen. Doesn't really matter who chooses who. You know, it turns out it does matter. Different from friendships and palships and other ships of our day, in which we think friendships are mutual. They have to be mutual. God choosing me or you is an act of grace, not an act of mutuality. On the other hand, me choosing God could be many things. It could just be dumb luck, or perhaps wisdom, or grasping at straws or an act of being on the right side for a couple of moments, but rarely is our choosing God grace. I grew up in a country sort of place, kind of like Gibsonville or Lexington. Mostly trees, fields, animals and pets, and a house here and there. The boys in the neighborhood gathered once school was over. It always seemed to end on the 15th of June. I don't know why. We gathered in this field down the dirt road from my house, and we took away winter's damage. We moved the stones, and we cut down the poison sumac, which we were scared to death of, and we dealt with all the heavings that had happened over the winter, and we fashioned a ball field every summer. It took us a couple of days to reclaim the field from all of the weeds and the heaving earth. It was a fair enough place, a little rough down the third base line, but other than that, pretty good place. And it was there that I learned how the world's choosing took place. I was, at that time, still am, a useless lefty among a horde of righties. I was a mediocre batter, and I was so short of, I suppose, testosterone that I was never on the top of any other boy's list when we went to choose up sides. Always choosing last, that was me. I felt like a leftover. And once chosen, and once all the good spots on the infield had been taken as we readied, I would station myself somewhere where no one else stood. I could catch, but I couldn't throw. I could talk, but I didn't know how to yell the right things. I could reason, but I couldn't argue with those on the other side that always took advantage of my side. And the games always had winners and losers. It was plain. I was not chosen. And to this day, I have not won a game. So later on in my life, in high school, I chose to be in the band. The band had no winners and no losers. And perhaps you yourself remember some of those same experiences about being chosen or not chosen. Or perhaps you remember being a chooser that did the choosing. But for me, once I got to high school and band, I was liberated. I remember on an episode of The Wonder Years some time ago, and maybe a few of you remember that TV show, Kevin, our hero and main character, knew this being chosen last experience. The phys ed teacher in his junior high, middle school, picked Kevin one day to be a team captain. So Kevin had to choose. First, he chose his best friend. One of the worst players, but Kevin felt good. He chose his best friend. In the next round, he chose another boy who was also a friend, and this other boy didn't play baseball very well either. So before the third round, the two that had already been chosen cried out to Kevin, "Pick some of the good players, we want to win." But Kevin kept picking losers and kept feeling good about his choices. And the losers felt good about being picked, and they knew they were going to lose badly. Indeed, they did. But as they thought about it, they could say, well, we enjoyed the game. A friend of mine, a pastor named Larry Spielman, talks about a couple of confirmation camps he led, where the confirmands from his congregation and several other Presbyterian congregations nearby would gather together for a weekend of study and play. On Saturday, Larry always made sure that there was a couple of volleyball games. And he asked before the first game of the weekend for those confirmands to raise their hands, all of them who did not know how to play. And he also had raised their hands those that knew they weren't very good players. So he told all of them to go on one side of the net, and he asked the other confirmands to go on the other side of the net. And then he took the players that knew nothing or knew little and said, there are some rules you need to learn. No criticizing one another. Play only in the place where you're assigned. Don't go racing all around and getting out of position. And finally, never score more than 2 points for your team when you serve. And he also taught the confirmands some basic ways to hit the volleyball. And Larry says that in 3 years and almost a dozen games between confirmands, the poor players never lost. They always had fun. Spielman says it's something about the power of love. And there's the word, love. The gospel writer would, in Greek, call it agape. The emphasis is on God's agape for us and our love for one another. Not on whether we love Jesus, not on whether we follow him to the letter of the law. In the Gospel of John, if you've read it, you know that there's this recurring theme in which John, one of the disciples of Jesus and perhaps the writer of the Gospel, is named over and over and over as the one that Jesus loved. And so you can imagine if he were asked, what's your primary identity? Who are you? He would not reply, well, I'm a disciple, or I'm one of the apostles, or I'm an evangelist. I'm the author of one of the four gospels. Now, he wouldn't say that. You know what he'd say? I'm the one Jesus loved. So what would it mean if you, when you were asked who you are, if you would state, I'm one that Jesus loves? Think about that. If that was the way you announced and saw yourself, would you be different than you are most of the time? There's a cute story of an Irish priest who walked on a walking tour of his rural parish one day, sees an older member of the parish kneeling alongside the road praying. The priest is impressed, and when the prayer ends, he says to the parishioner, you must be very close to God. And the man looks up from his position of prayer, and he thinks for a moment, and then he smiles and says, yes, God's very fond of me. If nothing else, every member of our congregation should think of themselves as, I am someone Jesus loves. And in the end, that's the way God's grace works. When I think of myself as someone whom Jesus loves. But here's our problem with that. We forget about grace. It's hard to remember about grace. And we find ourselves kind of thinking, well, who really cares? Jesus loves me, this I know. Rather, there's this irresistible temptation results in something like, watch me. I figured out how to choose God. I'm the smart one. I chose the Lord. Notice I did. So then, is God mightily impressed? Surely we think if 300 souls at Guilford Park chose God, then it's definite. God must love us. We say, well, what do you mean, Lord? Of course we chose you. We're Christians. We're Presbyterian church women and men. We worked through Kim Rao's confirmation class, or the session examined us and decided that we were Christians. Sure, we know that God loves us, but we chose ourselves to be here. We are among the elect. It's kind of like imagining a celestial baseball game in which God stands on one of the foul lines. He looks over all the members of Guilford Park and finally says, Amen. Barrier. Carol. Farmer. Haywood. Isakoff. Kirkpatrick. And Olson. You're on my team. The rest, you go play with the other team. Now, really, would we stand for a God like that? Come on. Well, unprompted, the gospel goes on to say the whole purpose for God's choosing is that we might have joy and have it abundantly. That's pleasant, we admit. But aren't we just a bit suspicious of a God who chooses me, chooses you, and then only wants us to be joyful? Surely choosing implies something more complicated, more complex, more lofty, proving what a great Christian I am. It might be good that God only wants the best for me, but that's a bit like the love between a parent and their 8-year-old child. The parent says, John or Sarah, I love you and I want you to clean up your room now. But we'd prefer it to be a little more mutual, wouldn't we? So we say back, Mom, if I have to clean up my room now, right this minute, I don't know, Mom, I might stop loving you. Which means, of course, you don't want to fool with me because I'll withhold my love from you and that would be terrible for you. Agape, used as a weapon. In fact, our faith teaches we're actually born enemies of God. We're actually the ones that aren't real impressed by grace. Now, to be a born enemy of God doesn't mean that we're all vicious. It doesn't mean that God is the enemy, but we know it's true. It means that infants and children think that they're the center of the universe. And thus, that kind of makes them God's enemy because somebody has to point out to them that they're not the center of the universe. God's the center of the universe. And anyone who defines themselves as the center of the universe makes a lesser being of everyone else around them. But surveys prove that the most widely known Bible verse among adults and teens is this one. God helps those who help themselves. Really, a wonderful verse, except it's not in the Bible. For too many, a world where we're not running things, we're not getting better at fixing things, just doesn't go down well. So, what about us? Folks that make up a Christian congregation. What's different if we give thought, such as, I've decided to follow Jesus, or I love the Lord, or you must be born again? We hear those things. They're not in the gospel either. No sentences about what God has done there. God's not the subject of the sentences. The sentences begin with, I or you. But sentences like God has chosen you, Jesus has appointed us to bear fruit, God loves you, that's gospel. And what's the difference? Jesus says that when God chooses to love me, I in turn respond by loving my sisters and my brothers. On the other hand, If I'm the one that gets to choose the God I want, I also get to choose the sisters and the brothers I want. And I'm not inclined to love everybody else. So when you realized God chose, when you really discovered God looked out there and chose you, something changed. That love changed you. You could choose to run from all that comes from God's loving you, run from all the abundance that Jesus explains comes to you. So we arrive at the end, and the question reappears, what's the difference if God chooses you instead of you choosing God? It's your business to figure that out, and soon. Amen.
To Jesus and live.
Please join me now in prayer. Let us pray. All praise and honor and thanksgiving be to you, O God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and our everlasting power and presence. Hear our prayers on this seventh Sunday of Easter and enable us to experience your love as we pray. As we look around and consider the majesty of your creation, O God, we are humbled and we want to cry out with joy for the beauty of the earth, for the revelation of your Son, for the implantation of your love in us, for your calling to us to be your ambassadors in this world through this church. Help us in our looking and in our calling, we pray. For we know we miss the mark when it comes to caring for your creation, such caring as you command at the very dawn of our own creation. And we also know we fall way short of seeing and understanding the life, death, and resurrection of your Son and his teachings on love and our unity as human beings on the basis of that love. Not only that, but we often remain oblivious to the real presence of your love in us and ignore your calling to ambassadorship. So forgive us, O God, and set us once again on the road of faithful discipleship. And as we travel that road, O God, we lift our prayers of intercession and supplication. We especially pray for those who suffer in so many ways, some known to us, all known to you. We pray for the sick in body, mind, or spirit, especially for those affected and infected by this coronavirus. And we pray for those doing what they can to alleviate suffering and those trying to find solutions. We also continue our prayers for those facing other ills of our society, like poverty and injustice, violence and evil. Our prayers are for all these who suffer, and our prayers are for strength and courage and wisdom on our own behalf to do what we can to help. And we pray for those with perhaps greater capacity to help, like governments and corporations and nonprofits and churches and schools and all the leaders of each. Be with them all as you are with each one of us, and instill unity of purpose, instill unity in love. So all praise and honor and thanksgiving be to you, O God, in this moment of prayer and in every moment of our lives, even as we pray aloud together the foundational prayer of our faith, the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
So the question comes again. God chose you. What difference? What difference does that make in your life? And now may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord be kind, gracious unto you. And may the Lord look on you with favor. And may the Lord give you peace. Amen.